I remember trying to be like, when should we have a kid? This is primary season.
Same.
But the general election is here. So if we do it at such and such a time, and I was like, I can't believe I'm doing this.
No, off-cycle babies are a real 100%. Thing. Everybody would get pregnant.
There was a lot
like,
of family planning happening on the bus in 2016.
When I tell you that joining the campaign trail as a reporter means giving up major parts of your life, I'm not joking. There really isn't an official campaign trail. That term describes the literal and metaphorical route a candidate takes to get their message to voters. But being on the bus and on the trail is a double metaphor. It refers to the posse of reporters that follow the candidate from city to city and the culture that surrounds them. Because over time, you become a club with a shared language. The file is the room where you can sit. The pen is where you're cordoned off at events. The fundraiser is known as the bagman, who ignores you. The candidate's personal assistant, or body man, who might not. A shared etiquette develops. Do grab an extra sandwich. Don't hog the power outlets. I've done that job, and so have my two guests today. Sharing this assignment, Amy Chosik. She covered politics for the Wall Street Journal and the New York Times. She's best known for her memoir, Chasing Hillary, about covering Clinton's presidential runs. And that book inspired a new Max TV show, The Girls on the Bus. Joining us, another alum from those campaign years, CNN anchor Abby Phillip. She was a consultant on the show.
And I've known Amy since I was a Cub campaign reporter. 2016? Yeah.
And the heady vintage days
of
2016.
I know. That was not my first... I mean, that was like not super early in my political career, but it was the first time I was like really on the bus with the campaign reporters, and we were covering Hillary.
And you started when, Amy?
I started covering Hillary in 2007. I covered her through the primary, 2008 primary. Then I switched to Obama, covered him through the general, early years of the Obama White House. And then I was put back on the Hillary beat in 2015 and covered her in 2016 campaign with Abby. In fairness, we all knew Abby was going to be a star. Huh. Could just tell
you
in those
known,
long stretches in Iowa, there was something special about Abby. And yeah, so we met and you form very tight relationships when you're stuck on a bus with someone for that long in a complicated sometimes dark campaign.
I do have the experience of doing this pre-social media, not pre-50s, everyone settled down, but like pre, I didn't follow them on the railroad, but
were
I
you
do,
on the McGovern bus?
I was, it was a rough time. It was more that, let's just put it this way, I remember my first campaign proper having a BlackBerry. And when the plane took off.
I miss a BlackBerry.
Everyone raised their arms into the air. Because you had to keep the Wi-Fi going until the very last minute.
Yes. Yep.
And then you were dead, okay? And it was like, if you didn't file, if you didn't do whatever. And this was also during the period when newsletters are kicking into high gear, like ABC's The Note, et cetera.
Yeah.
And so the reason why I bring this up is because these are the elements that start to accelerate the pace of reporting. And I could hear some of the older reporters on the bus complaining about it, right? Fast forward to me watching your show, and that's literally the show.
That is very much the perspective we're bringing to these characters, right? Especially Sadie McCarthy, the kind of old school print reporter. She's been romanticizing this era of the boys on the bus, right? They filed once a day. They talked to the they got drinks with the candidates. And like after you filed, it was just like you're this rollicking party. And it's like, oh, by the time they let women and minorities on the bus, we have to file all the time. The news industry is dying.
Yeah.
And you like can have no fun. And the candidates completely ignore you.
Oh, so it's like being the black president in a disaster movie.
Okay.
It's like you're
yes.
Morgan Freeman. That's my theory. You get there and it's like, surprise, asteroid.
Yes. And that's something actually an Obama aide had told me early on. It's like, but God, by the time women and minorities get to the presidency, the role has been vastly diminished. I think it's something that's sort of universal around industries. But of course, we're looking at journalism. And as you said, like the campaign bus has completely changed. Probably starting with your BlackBerry story, you know, 2008 was very similar. By 2016, everyone was afraid that you're going to go viral on Instagram. And certainly suddenly now, especially in Donald Trump, you have a candidate who circumvents the media entirely and goes directly to his voters and speaks directly through them with social media. So the role of the bus has vastly changed. And I think our girls, specifically Sadie, because she's like an old soul, she like really wanted to write words that matter. And now by the time she gets her dream, people are saying, nobody believes anything in your newspaper anyway. Like, what is truth?
Even as this show is about the future and about the present, it also feels kind of vintage already.
Yeah.
I mean, this cycle that we're in, 2024, is the second completely non-traditional presidential cycle where there's basically no bus.
Right. there, oh, talk more about
there's
that.
There's basically no press corps, like even what we experienced in 2016, what folks would have experienced certainly in 2008 in that cycle. Yeah. The embed reporters are flying basically on their own by themselves. The candidates are essentially incumbents on both sides. Mm-hmm. They are treated like incumbents on both sides. They have a built-in kind of entourage around them that keeps them in
protected.
The tightest of bubbles.
Yeah.
And even when I was covering 2020 before COVID, mm-hmm. even the candidates who probably were not entitled to be in a bubble were in bubbles.
Mm.
So the campaign is already changing
from
what this show depicts in a wild way that has completely, I think, upended what you get from the bus.
Traditionally, air quotes, the traveling press corps, you're in a group and you quite literally are traveling together en masse, like to this hotel, to that Embassy Suites, mm-hmm. to that Marriott.
Yeah. Yeah.
Sometimes the campaign is involved in that wrangling. I've certainly been on a bus where all of a sudden the wrangler, so to speak, comes on and says, this bus is leaving in 10 minutes, and if you're not back, we're leaving without you, right? And or they provided the lunch or et cetera. And I had the experience of traveling to multiple campaigns. I was often the angel of death. I was sent to your campaign when it was dying.
Oh,
yeah,
oh, we
I
love
that
job.
That
I've done
job.
That.
You've done that job.
Like, you don't want me on your campaign.
Okay,
yeah.
Exactly.
I'm a campaign killer.
You also walk into the clique of that traveling press corps.
Right.
Do you know what I'm talking about?
Oh, when I switched to Obama
social thing.
From Hillary in 08, it was very much like, oh my, I don't know any of them, and they all know each other. And
People sit, I remember sitting down in an airplane seat and someone being like, oh,
yes,
that's so-and-so's seat
that's
from Time Magazine.
Yes.
And I was like, am I in a lunchroom? Because I'll
that's
be triggered.
What it feels
I don't
like.
Have the 100% ability
are.
To deal with
that's
this.
That's what it feels like.
For you, what was that like? How social was it?
Well, it's funny you say that because when I started, I had been a foreign correspondent in Japan when my boss at the Wall Street Journal, he'd been Asia bureau chief. He became Washington bureau chief. And he called me and said, how'd you like to go to Iowa and cover Hillary Clinton? I'd been in Tokyo for 2 years. So I was like, I hardly knew who Obama was. I didn't know what the caucus was. Of course, nobody really understands what the caucus is. So I was not alone in that. But when I arrived, there was like a real, who is this girl? Like, you know, the Washington reporters know each other. They roll in the same circles. They're taking sources to the same restaurant. I didn't know any of that world. So there was a real, I felt like, and also I still, in fairness, dress like a Japanese teenager. So I very much felt like the weirdo.
You are, in fact, wearing plaid pants right now.
That's true. That's fair. That's fair. That's okay.
I was like, this tracks.
And a nameplate necklace.
Yes.
So you brought it.
So I did very much feel like the outsider. Like, I think that actually made my stories better in some ways because I didn't have access to all the, like, scoops that everyone was chasing. So I saw things that maybe other reporters, like, I did a front page story for the Wall Street Journal about campaign hookups. You know, it's like, of course people hook up on campaigns, but, like, readers don't. I was like, really? Readers don't know that. So I did some fun, I think, outsider pieces, which was what my editors wanted at the time.
And but, when you say outsider, I think of something, just to give an example, because you bring up the campaign hookups. A lot of the TV show is about that social aspect of it and the physical and emotional connections that can grow that I think to outsiders, they see access journalism and kind of everything that is wrong with journalism.
Right.
Well, these are people and they're spending a ton of time together in kind of crappy situations.
We're eating turkey, you're getting turkey sandwiches like, thrown at you. Yeah.
That's the thing about being on the campaign is that you're bonding under pressure,
and we should say that in part because there's so much dead time.
Yeah,
so there's
you're
the
just,
travel time
sitting
itself.
Around.
Then you might see the candidate for a minute, and then there's another long wait,
yes,
maybe,
yes,
while
like,
they're in with the
blonde
fundraiser.
Bob, and then you'd be like,
they're in a living room, yeah, and now you're waiting outside,
yeah,
right? Like,
yeah,
there's a lot of waiting.
And from cycle to cycle, you're spending a lot of time, mm-hmm, with the body man, okay?
The body man is, yeah, quite literally the guy who's like, you need a pen? He hands the candidate,
yeah,
a pen.
You, yeah,
need an orange juice?
Hand
he hands
sanitizer.
You're,
yeah,
standing,
exactly,
in a hallway, and they're, you know. And so all of that downtime, I think, produces weird stuff and weird closeness. And that's real. I mean,
and
how much access
space
it really gets you, I think, is very questionable. But
there's your home newsroom. Mm-hmm. Then there's your actual home. And then there's a space in between with all of these people who you work with slash compete with.
That's the very interesting layer to all of these friendships, right? It's like, I knew everything about these girls' lives, and we'd share, yeah, everything about each other. But it's like, don't look at my— is Annie looking at my screen? Yeah. Don't look at my screen. I don't want to hear my phone call.
Amy was the one, but I was in, let's just, as an example, when I was in 2016, she was the one who would disappear, and you're like, oh, crap, where did Amy Chozick go? She's going to go have a scoop. And then there would be a scoop the next morning on the front page of the New York Times. So it was like, you know, whenever you see someone like Amy disappear on the bus, you know it's because something is coming.
You go in the bathroom to make a call.
And I remember at one point I was very new and I would file my reports because I was the radio person. And then I'd get on the bus and they might be playing NPR. And now everyone on the bus has heard my take on the day.
NPR's Audie Cornish was at that rally in Reno. And Audie, how much of Obama's speech today was devoted to tying McCain to Bush?
Probably a good 90% of it. Senator Obama took to the stage, and the first thing he did was thank people for sending well wishes to him and to his grandmother and how much it meant to him. And it was sort of a sweet
And
I felt
moment.
So self-conscious about it. And you know what I mean?
I was
it
say,
felt.
That's cool.
Well, it
You're
is.
You're narrating
but,
the race.
Yeah. But for people who are in the room,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
And I did feel sometimes like, oh no, am I starting to write for the people
that's
that I'm traveling
yes.
with?
Yeah. Yes.
And that's true. You do write for those people. I actually, it's such a good point because reflecting on it, one of the things that I kind of did not like a lot of times about the press corps environment was that it was so insular. And sometimes I felt like I was chasing stories because it was what my peers would have cared about. But then I would question, does anybody else care about this? Does it really matter? Or is it just like a status thing to try to make the other reporters on the bus feel like I am connected or like I know what's going on?
To Abby's point, what I saw in 2016 that I didn't see in 2008 is not only trying to impress the kind of navel-gazing of the bus, but also, like, to me, that's Twitter. It's like,
yeah,
what's going to get them? In 2016, it was like, oh, what's going to get the most traffic on? And it's like, but that doesn't even really, that doesn't reflect the country. And I think to Abby's point, you're like in this bubble. You go through Secret Service and actually on set, this was really important to me, like everyone has to get sweat before they go on the bus. So it's very hard to talk to actual voters. Like in Iowa, New Hampshire, mm-hmm, in the early primary states, you could really get in there. But like once you're traveling in like to 20 different states, it was very hard to talk to voters and get out of the security bubble. And so it's weird. You're going and you're only seeing one side, right?
So describe
so
a typical event. You land at, let's say, a New Hampshire restaurant, diner, because
yeah,
the candidate is going to do a visit.
Yep.
What happens?
The bus pulls up. You're like, you're already swept by Secret Service. You have to stay in the bubble. You're like ushered into the restaurant or
and
the bubble. Usually
literally
a high school
just
gym.
The perimeter around the bus. You're using all the terms.
Right.
But
sorry.
Like,
sorry. Yes.
It just means.
That means you haven't ventured out where someone could like give you a weapon that you bring in close
yeah.
contact.
I mean, the
with
bubble is really whatever they say it is.
Yeah.
So basically, you stay in their eye shot and
yeah.
you're clean. So you don't have to get swept again. And as long as you're in the bubble, you're good and you can continue with the candidate.
And getting swept, wanded,
et cetera, yeah.
takes time.
It does. And they have to sniff your bags. And there's a lot of time they'll find some marijuana gummies in there, but they don't care about that. They're looking for weapons. The dogs are sniffing your bags every day. But I think
before you enter said diner.
Right. Or high school gym. Usually high school gym. And the thing is like when I first pitched this to producers, I was like, and we go to Miami, we go to Vegas. And they're like, this sounds so expensive to make. And I was like, no. We don't see the country. You see the inside
you
of a bus.
You don't see those cities.
No. You see them maybe out the window. Like, oh, you're like, there's the arch in St. Louis. How pretty. Like, so, and then you're going into the high school gym, you're hearing the same speech that we basically had memorized. How much can we talk about the 3D printer, right?
Yeah.
And then you're like immediately wrestled back into the bus. And
so when you're in the event,
yeah.
You're what they call, you're in the pen, air quotes.
Yes, like a press file.
So, again, you're using a term that makes it sound really impressive.
No, it's usually, folding tables.
It's folding chairs and folding tables where we as press are allowed to sit.
Yes.
Because we're still in the bubble.
Yeah, I think the point of being in the bubble as a campaign reporter is to understand the candidate's evolution and decision making. Mm-hmm. It's not the best place to understand what's going on in the electorate.
Yeah.
And that's the trade-off.
Do you even have access to that, though, if you don't have access to the candidate?
I think that there's a lot of observation that happens.
Yeah.
I mean, Amy is a Clintonologist. Like, she literally understood Hillary Clinton better than, I think, any reporter who covered her in over the course of a couple cycles. And that's what you get when you spend a lot of time with a candidate.
But you're saying you had that Clintonology, so to speak, from the entire atmosphere, not from her, because you talk a lot about not connecting
with her.
A little
bit from her, too. I mean,
yeah, you observe her, like, everywhere you go, to your diner and your bowling alleys and all of these things, and you overhear all of her conversations.
And every once in a while, she would come back on the plane and talk to us for a few minutes, and it wasn't a lot. But you learn a lot about a person. You talk to people who are very close to them. You find out what kind of moods they're in, what they're happy about, what they're sad about. Like, you learn a little too much about the candidate at a certain point. And you start to also read the tea leaves in a way that's probably unhealthy.
Yeah.
You're just like, you're like, oh, their hair was a little askew today. What's going on?
Right.
You know, it's...
Any kind of variation in the message, you know, you hear.
Yeah.
But it's interesting because when you were saying it's not the best way to understand the electorate, it's also not the best way to understand the inner workings of the campaign. Like, often I'd be like, what's happening in Brooklyn? Because I've been in, you know, Detroit listening to her economic speech, and meanwhile her campaign is in turmoil in Brooklyn. So it's like, it's a funny beast.
There was a period just before that end of social media, and Obama was someone who also was like, it was a little closed off. His people were extremely disciplined. Mm-hmm. And Hillary obviously distrusted the press for a variety of reasons. So when I arrived there, following in New Hampshire, I was following from the back. You were on the bus. I was in the back. And what I noticed is that I had more fun following the campaign from a distance.
Mm.
Once I gave up on access and spent all my time talking to voters, it felt like a qualitatively different experience.
Yeah.
How do you think about it now?
Look, it's very expensive to send someone out on the campaign trails. If you have the luxury of maybe having like someone younger on the bus all the time, but then, you know, the Abbeys of the world, the ability to go in and out, I think that's probably ideal. But I will say if the choice is being on the bus or sitting in your cubicle in New York or Washington and watching it on TV and on Twitter, 100%. Like, you should be on the bus. Like, at least you're seeing the country. At least you're hearing the speeches. At least you're, you know, even I would come back and say, I don't see any Hillary yard signs in Ohio, but there's so many Obama yards. You know, there were just things like that that we sort of took for granted. Oh, but the data says this, the data says that. Like, there's nothing more valuable than getting out and seeing the country. If you can pop in and out with the candidate to the diner without the bubble, that's great. But like, sitting in your cubicle is not the answer.
I'm talking with Amy Chosik and Abby Phillip. We'll be back in a moment.
We all do things our own way. And since the way that each of us sleeps is unique, you need a bed that fits you just the right way. Sleep Number smart beds make your sleep experience as individual as you are, using cutting-edge technology to give you effortless, high-quality sleep every night. J.D. Power ranks Sleep Number number one in customer satisfaction with mattresses purchased in-store. And now, during Sleep Number's President's Day sale, save 50% on the Sleep Number limited edition smart bed plus special financing for a limited time. For J.D. Power 2023 award information, visit jdpower.com/awards. Only at Sleep Number stores or sleepnumber.com. See store for details.
New year, same phone addiction? Break the cycle of Sundays lost to doom scrolling on Elon Musk's haunted Twitter by tuning into Crooked Media's weekly podcast, Offline with me, Jon Favreau. Offline is a different kind of Sunday show, a chance to step outside our social media-fueled news cycles and hear smarter, lighter conversations about how our chronically online existence shapes the ways we live, work, and interact with the world around us. Join us each week for intimate conversations with notable guests like Stephen Colbert, Hassan Piker, ContraPoints, and Margaret Atwood. Together, we'll figure out how to live healthier, happier lives, both on and offline. So put down your screens, grab your headphones, and listen to new episodes of Offline with Jon Favreau every Sunday, wherever you get your podcasts.
Welcome back. I'm talking with political reporters Amy Chosik and Abby Phillip about life on the campaign trail.
Another thing I would hear on the bus is someone making a sad phone call to their spouse.
Oh.
Literally missing the game. Missing the school play.
Oh, yeah. Reading the story to their 18-month-old.
Yeah.
And
oh, yes. Yeah.
I mean, there was
one of
a
our
lot
friends,
of that.
Right? Reading.
Yeah.
I remember sitting in the hallway of the Democratic National Convention and watching her do the reading of the book through FaceTime in a crowded hallway.
There is a life cycle of the girls on this show.
But also, if you go back and read The Boys on the Bus, the only women, it's an iconic book. I still love it. But, like, the only women in that book are, like, putting in a pot roast after their heroic men get back from their primary covering the debates. And so I think it's like showing the women's their whole lives are dumpster fires. Like,
and what was the line? You have to be both Martha Stewart and Bob Woodward at the same time. True.
Yeah.
That is true.
Can't be a childless mess.
Amy, what was it like translating your experience? You had written it as a memoir.
Yeah.
But now you have to write a teleplay or you have to help write a fictional depiction. What are the things you really wanted to translate, and what are the things that you were willing to play around with for the sake of entertainment?
What made me really excited about this project was that we're playing in a fictional world. I did not want to relive 2016. We didn't want to live in a Hillary Trump world. And to Abby's point of it feeling sort of vintage, I think it's idealistic. I think it is like a version of politics and media that will be hopefully an escape, because right now it's pretty dark. So that was exciting to me. It's funny. Less than like, oh, I must get this anecdote from the book into the show. It was more like my partner, Rena Mamoon, I would come into the writer's room and she'd say, what's a conversation you wish you had had that you've like played out in your head a million times? I wish I'd had this conversation with
the
candidate.
I'll be honest, I saw a couple moments of that.
Yeah.
There was a moment where your Hillary stand-in, your elusive candidate, stops the elevator and lectures the main character.
Yes.
Sadie McCarthy, still as bumbling as ever, I see. Sorry? You should be. You and your newspaper ruined my life. You cost me the presidency. With your snark and your sarcasm disguised as wit and whimsy. And that viral meltdown that set women back 100 years, that was embarrassing.
Yes. And I thought, this is fantasy and I love it. Because it's the idea of a politician telling us what they really think.
Right.
Thank you. That's actually one of them. So even more than like, I need this real thing to happen, it was much more like, what do you imagine or what do you wish would happen? Of course, we never got private conversations on the candidate's bus. Like, it's a TV show. You have to extend reality. Sadie sneaks on the bus. They have a private conversation, very much a conversation I've had, an imaginary conversation I've had in my head that I got to kind of write my heart out for. The things I was, like, very annoying and adamant about were, as you said, the messy press file. We had, you know, the yellow tail at the bar, the credentials, even the bus. So, like, a bus is very, very hard to shoot on. It's, like, impossible. So there were all kinds of creative ideas from our crew to, like, maybe we put sofas in, like, reconfigure the seats. And I was like, no. It's called the girls' bus. It has to look like a Greyhound.
One of the things that I worried would bother me, so I'm just going to say it.
Please.
Every journalist who is a woman in every piece of entertainment sleeps with her source.
Fair. Okay, this was something. First of all, I meet with the writers for the first time, and I'm like, no, she can't have sex with this person. She can't have sex with... I like every idea. I was like, no, they can't sleep with a candidate. You know, it was like every kind of, and I love Shonda Said With Love, but like every soapy thing was like, no, that actually like can't happen in reality, right?
Yeah, but also like, this will not be a TED Talk.
That's okay.
It feels like one of the things that annoys people about journalists / woman is getting in your face, asking questions, being where you're not supposed to be.
Yeah.
And so Hollywood has to gin up a reason why a woman would be let in a room asking questions.
How can you get this? How
could this have happened?
And I think this was really important to me.
Well, you need to have had a relationship with someone.
So this was really important to me. She had a relationship. To Abby's point, you're in my story about campaign hookups. You're on the road. You're going to hook up with the bartender at the Marriott or like a bag man on the campaign trail. Like, it's almost like a camp environment. Like, who else are you meeting, right? So Sadie had a relationship with someone who was very low level.
Yeah.
Sadie, the main character, had a relationship with someone who was a bag man, very low level, not a conflict 4 years ago. Flash forward, He's been promoted. He's the press secretary. It's a conflict. And I think what's important about the storyline is, like, she's not sleeping with him to get information. It's like a huge problem. This has come back to haunt her, and she pays very, very dearly, called into a disciplinary hearing, you know, sort of branded with this, like, huge mistake that she made, that she apologizes profusely for, that she shows never impacted her coverage. And I think what I really wanted to show with this was to actually flip that cliche of journalism movies that, like, drives us crazy on its head and say, like, who were the boys on the bus hooking up with? Like, come on. And
nobody,
like,
talks about nobody talks about that.
Right.
But it was happening.
Of course it was happening.
But do you think it's because women were not in the same positions of power?
I think women have zero margin for error. And there was a very famous story around that period when a female journalist had had a relationship with a source, and Abe Rosenthal, the executive editor of the New York Times, fired her. And there's this famous quote that you can cover the circus, but you can't F the elephants. Right? And I just
never heard that before.
Yeah.
That's
and
a good
I
one.
Just don't think
that's a good one.
I don't think, like, if you tell me there were no men having questionable sexual relationships in that period, like, I've never heard about one being, like, dragged out and, you know, walk of shame. And so hopefully Sadie writes this manifesto that she's, like, sick of Hollywood portraying journalists as getting female journalists as getting their information through sex, when the fact is we have zero margin for error. And you mess up once, and it's like, you know, real characters and especially fictional characters make mistakes. And of course, she makes one. She pays for it dearly.
I think also, yeah. I mean, that part of the storyline, I think, was less central to me than Sadie's constantly kind of, like, falling in love with the candidate
that
she's covering.
Yeah.
And I think as a journalist—
And speaking of her hopefully, and speaking about what she wished she would do, she has a very sort of naked— and public support for the candidate.
That was the part that, like, I had the most.
That's you're covering your heart. I feel you, like, having palpitations.
No, that's the love story that made you, like,
yeah, because that's the part that I think creates the most tension for her.
Yeah.
Where she wants to be this, like, real journalist, but she keeps falling for the spin of these candidates.
Yeah, and I love Grace's character, Carla Gugino's character, who's like, oh my God, you're so, like, naive, and they're all power hungry. I think that was, I love Sadie's idealism, but yes, it gets her into trouble. And I think it is, like, you talk about, like, us covering him, it kind of feels like you're in love, but there is no love, right? You think about this person constantly. They think about you never. And I think, you know, you know, and there's, like, you know what they eat. Like, Sadie shows up in episode 2 and she's, like, at Chintro, our Iowa restaurant, our Des Moines restaurant, and she knows what the candidate is ordering. Like, you know every detail about them. And so that confrontation in the elevator is, like, really heartbreaking for Sadie. But I think the journey we're on with Sadie is, like, okay, you're not perfect. You're not who I thought you were. And I think that, I don't know if you felt this. For me, it was a little bit sad in a way to see the candidates up close, because I would see, like, a million people, like, losing their minds for Obama, and they were so hopeful, and they were so, and I was like, oh, that looks fun. You kind of seed your ability to see these people as, like, heroes, because they're all human, right? They're all, you see their flaws, you see their humanity. And so I think that was something we, like, grasped on early on, that it's, like, a little bit sad.
Then there's a chicken or egg factor because the candidates have become more shut down, more performative, precisely because so many people have the sole job of only watching them and waiting for them to slip up.
Yeah.
There's literally no incentive for them to be vulnerable.
Completely.
Yeah. I mean, the candidates at this point, less is more, right? Because they can control so much of the narrative. That's the other part about the campaign reporter life that has really changed. I mean, part of the reason for the press corps is because usually the media was the reason that all of this information got to the world in a certain way. That is obviously no longer.
Right.
And on top of that, I mean, the idea of these sort of, like, internet native reporters who are constantly live streaming and maybe they have a perspective, that is also depicted in the show. And it's a real thing that's accelerating at the same time,
too. Yeah, there's a character who's your Gen Z stand-in, and she's constantly live streaming. She talks about her follower count.
Yeah.
She herself is her own political brand,
yeah,
but she's now encountering a culture of actual reporting.
Lola's the character that, actually, to Abby's point, was even evolving as we wrote it. Like, I don't think I would have written Substack into the script 2 years ago. And now it's like she has a subscription Substack that's paying her what? Yeah, the sponsored content.
Someone is paying her in advance to make a newsletter.
Exactly.
But you also have a moment where a candidate staffer is saying, you're going to get to do an interview, air quotes. Here are all the talking points and questions in order.
Yeah.
Read this.
Yeah. Well, this is Lola, and I love Lola's evolution because she does go from being, like, totally in the tank for our sort of AOC-type candidate. I'm here as an activist. I'm here to get her elected. And then as she bonds with the girls and learns what they do, she starts to get really uncomfortable with the candidate treating her just like a megaphone and, like, taking advantage of her. And she starts to really want to become a real journalist.
You know, at the end of the day, I don't think I've ever seen anything quite so idealistic and hopeful depicting journalism culture, which was really fascinating to watch in this moment politically where people feel the opposite. And I know you said this is about escapism. Who do you think it's for?
Well, certainly we would love to appeal to young women. I mean, one of the things about the journalism hopefulness, a big inspiration for us, well, broadcast news, Almost Famous. Do you remember Almost Famous?
Of course.
You know, and like when I watched that, I was like, oh my God, I want to work for Rolling Stone. I want to get on the bus with Cameron Crowe. I want to travel with the band. And
I want to chronicle the lives of sad groupies.
Yeah. It looked fun. I mean, even like politics being dark aside, like I think journalism, it's dark right now. And I think, and
it's not, but it's not just the journalism. Yeah. It's like if you follow the Trump campaign, and I'll say this as well, I watched a friend cover that campaign. The crowd is whipped up against you during the course of any given said event.
Yeah.
Right? Like, the atmosphere is different.
Right. Well, I think it's a strange year when we didn't have a primary. I think primaries get so hopefully, like, the culture of the bus is not dead forever.
I hope not.
I mean, I hope the show, like, it, like young people watch it and think being a journalist looks cool. Like, I want to be on that bus.
Well,
like, that looks fun.
People do always ask me about this.
Yeah.
I mean, it's like, the number one thing.
Bus.
Just, like, what is it like to cover a candidate. I think people genuinely want to know. And this show being centered on the women on the bus, the girls on the bus, is actually really different because I think even the journalism shows are really it's like about the candidate. Mm-hmm. And then the reporters are kind of like ancillary to the story.
Right. Wearing brown, skulking around, unpermed hair.
This really takes you inside. Kind of, you know, it's like a fun, fictionalized version.
I was
going to
say, they're also like, or like sanctimonious. It's like, we're the big men speaking truth to power. And I think it's like, they're all people. Like, their personal lives are dumpster fires because they're giving their lives to this job. They want, and they're working so hard to find the truth. And Sadie does believe that the truth still matters. And I think,
to the detriment of their relationships back home.
Completely. Yeah.
Et cetera,
exactly.
Right? Like, this is the life.
Yeah. So I hope it shows that. And then I was like, I was really intrigued. Like during the Trump years, there was a massive boom in people binging the West Wing. And I do think, like when you're looking at our crowded, raucous, funny primary, like hopefully people can say, okay, there's a political cycle happening in reality. And then there's this escapist one where Scott Foley does a Magic Mike striptease in episode 3.
Something to look forward to.
Yeah.
Folks.
Wow. Failed my job actually as a critic by not diving into that more. Well, Amy and Abby, thank you so much for talking to us about this.
Thank you. This was a blast.
It was so great to reminisce.
So fun with Abby.
That's former campaign reporter Amy Chosik, creator and executive producer of The Girls on the Bus. The show is streaming now on Max, which is, of course, like CNN, owned by Warner Brothers Discovery. We also heard from Abby Phillip, my colleague and host of CNN's Newsnight with Abby Phillip. That's it for this episode of The Assignment. We'd love to hear what's on your mind, and our number is 202-854-8802. Remember, we might use your voicemail in a future episode of our show. This episode of The Assignment, a production of CNN Audio, was produced by Carla Javier. Matt Martinez is our senior producer. Dan DeZula is our technical director. Steve Lichtai is the executive producer of CNN Audio. We also got support from Haley Thomas, Alex Manasseri, Robert Mathers, John Dianora, Lenny Steinhardt, Jameis Andrus, Nicole Pesaru, and Lisa Namarau. Shout out to Benjamin Evans, Nick Godsell, and Taylor Phillips for your help with this week's very special episode. Special thanks, as always, to Katie Hinman. I'm Audie Cornish. Thank you for listening.
We all do things our own way. And since the way that each of us sleeps is unique, you need a bed that fits you just the right way. Sleep Number smart beds make your sleep experience as individual as you are, using cutting-edge technology to give you effortless, high-quality sleep every night. J.D. Power ranks Sleep Number number one in customer satisfaction with mattresses purchased in-store. And now, the Queen Sleep Number C4 smart bed is only $15.99, save $300, only for a limited time. For J.D. Power 2023 award information, visit jdpower.com/awards. Only at a Sleep Number store or sleepnumber.com.